back too, right?
Yeah. Bye, goodbye.
When he was 5 years old, we saw a show that your dad performed at work. It was a different kind of show. This one is more like a mind kind of thing. You know, it's really, really interesting.
You know, I know the family since I'm a kid, so I know he was always running around, doing magic stuff, but I didn't realize he had become such an accomplished illusionist and magician. So,
is this your first time seeing the show?
Yes, first time. First time.
Is it possible to predict the future? Is it really possible to predict the future? What do you think?
No.
No, skeptics, huh? Anybody say yes?
Yes.
All right, we have kind of both. Well, you know what, I don't really know the answer to that question, but maybe, just maybe, the answer is inside of this scroll. Many years ago, when I was a kid, I had the opportunity to meet one of the greatest mentalists who ever lived. His name was Joseph Dunninger. Some of you might have heard of him. Here you go. In my opinion, the greatest feat that Dunninger ever performed was his prediction of a chosen telephone number. Anyway, after years of practice and experimentation, trial and error, tonight, together with your help, we are going to attempt what many consider to be the most difficult feat in all of mentalism, Joseph Dunninger's telephone number prediction test. But in order to do so, I will need the assistance of the entire audience. So all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
My name is Steve Sussman. We're here at J. Sussman Incorporated, which is a family-owned business since 1906. J. Sussman Inc. today manufactures architectural metal specialties all over the world. Many in Washington, D.C., many prestigious windows, which is fun. Wherever I go, my wife will tell you, I'm always pointing out all the projects that we've done. It makes it kind of fun. Usually our windows are high-end, and they are unique, which gives you, you know, a lot of latitude for creativity. Magic has been a part of my life for probably close to 50 years. And sometimes it's, you know, you can't just press a button and take it out of your life. It seems no matter what I do, magic is always part of it, all right? Even in my business, even though I might not have performed magic, I have done many seminars on products that we've created over here. And it's because of the showmanship that I learned from being a magician that helped me enhance my seminars around the country. And you can't get much better marketing than doing something like that. I could do all the advertising I want, but when I do a show within my own industry, it's probably the best marketing that you can get. There you go, one goes over here, good, just like that. Watch closely. I take one band, I place it over Teresa's hands just like that, and I ask you once again, is there any way, without taking the bands off my fingers, is there any way I can get the band through the other band? Anyway, impossible? No way?
Impossible.
Watch close. Solid rubber. Hold your hand a little further apart. Can't go this way. Can't go this way. Watch closely.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, one of my earliest memories of actually performing magic was when I performed for my mother's mahjong group. And one of the things was, when I was younger, I had a stuttering and cluttering problem. I had a speech impediment. And one of the things I found that whenever I did something scripted, my stuttering would stop. And when I gave this performance in front of 75 to 100 people, I didn't stutter at all. And I remember after the performance, a lot of my mother's friends walking around saying, and this is the stutterer? Robbie, we begin by having you open the phone book, make sure everything is in order, nothing is unusual, make sure all the pages are consecutively numbered and they are alphabetized. I'm glad he doesn't inspect our weapons. Okay, Robbie, would you please open the book to the last page of the book? That's the one on that side. That's correct. Okay, good. And that's it. When I say last numbered page, tell us how many pages there are in the book.
How many?
877. Now, there are approximately 500 phone numbers per page, meaning there are over 500,000 or over 500,000 phone numbers in this book. And tonight, we're going to select one number, one lucky number, out of over 500,000 phone numbers. Okay? So let us begin by selecting a page. I need three individuals to each call out single-digit numbers. Someone who has not participated on this side, call it any number between 1 and 10. Yes? No, a single-digit number. Four. That's a good one. Okay, a four, right? Someone over here who has not participated.
Six.
Oh, I don't trust a tennis player. Four, six. Okay, four, six. And one more person.
Eight.
468. Robbie, would you please open the book to page 468? Take your time, paid by the hour. Have we got it? 468. Poor book. Your poor book will never be the same. Okay?
It's never 468.
You're right. It's a page torn out of the book. Could you?
There was a magic store in New York City called the Magic Center. And I would go there every weekend. I lived in Flushing. I would travel by the subway every weekend. I'd go to the Magic Center. I would buy books constantly, and there was a person, a magician there, who kind of took me under his wing. His name was Al Stevenson, and he was really my first teacher. He had a group lesson going. I think it was $25 for 10 lessons, and then you get a bonus lesson at the end. The bonus lesson was you get to see Slydini, who was one of the greats, one of the greatest magicians who ever lived, and he performed for us, magic that I've never seen since. Nothing comparable. And today, even today, Slydini is considered to be one of the three greatest close-up magicians who's ever lived. Eventually, the group disbanded, except for me. So what ended up being a group lesson from Slydini, a one-hour lesson, became a private lesson just for myself, and it became a Sunday thing. Not only for 1 hour, but I would spend almost the whole day with Slydini for about 3 years, from the age of 15 above. And that was a tremendous part of my life. Sophia Loren, whenever she came to New York, she would go to Slydini's house. You have some great movie actors that knew of Slydini. Not many did, because he was a close-up magician. He was a stage magician also, but really his real forte was close-up magic. Mentalism is an area where people still believe in. Most modern day, most people today do not believe in magic because it's been exposed so much, and people don't expect, if somebody wakes up with a silver dollar in their hand, they know that wasn't magic. It just doesn't happen. However, everyone has had a psychic experience of some sort or another. And during my show, while I try to make it seem real, after the show, I'll be the first person to admit that nothing I do is supernatural. Everything I do there are sound scientific reasons for it.
I'm going to start now. Call or stop whenever you want. Okay, Rhonda, I can stop here, which makes my job very easy. I can continue down or I can go back up. What do you prefer? Oh, I like a woman who can make up her mind. Would you please, Robbie, call out the number?
379-4901.
379-4901. Write in big bold letters 379. Big letters. 4901. Okay. Captain Walker, take the board. Stand in front of the table, if you will. Let's hold it up high so everyone can see it. Okay. Out of over 500,000 phone numbers in this book, one number was chosen under the fairest possible manner, and that number is, audience, what's the number?
379-4901.
A few moments ago, I asked this audience, is it possible to predict the future? I believe with this audience, this wonderful, incredible audience right here at the Bryant Library from Roswell, New York, I think anything's possible. One more time, hold that up. I didn't tell you to put it down. What's the number?
379-4901.
Who's got the scroll?
I do.
Come on up here. You should be an actor. You're in the wrong business. And come on, Rhonda, come up here also. Would you please, Wayne, take the ribbon off? Rhonda, come here. Don't open it yet, Wayne. Would you please, Rhonda, hold. Wait, you hold the scroll. Rhonda will hold the scroll. One more time, 3794901, open the scroll. We did. Give them a round of applause. Come on.
People very often ask me, how did I get into magic, or what made me get into it? And I think the best answer probably would be by a famous magician that passed away maybe almost 10 years ago, and his name was Don Allen. And they asked Don Allen, why did you become a magician? And Don Allen said, you don't become a magician because you want to be a magician. You become a magician because you have to be a magician. There's something inside of you that makes you get into that.